Thanks for coming to my talk. I'm Ronald Huissen. I work for the platform of civil rights protection in Holland that has been suing the Dutch government with a coalition of NGOs for the use of a data analysis risk profiling system. First of all, I'll give you a short introduction on SyRI to talk about what it is, what it does, what it's supposed to do. Then we go to our objections with SyRI and why we sued the Dutch state. Third part will be how we saw the public debate on SyRI shift in the past year. And I will give a short future perspective about our court case and the publicity campaign and the debate in Holland on digital technologies. I'm Ronald Huissen, a journalist and researcher, as Giuliano already told you. I tend to focus on social topics when it comes to digital technology. So in opposition to anti-terrorism measures or predictive policing, or I tend to focus on the social aspect of digital technologies and their implementations. First of all, I want to introduce SyRI to you.
Wanneer u belastingaangifte doet, een rollator nodig heeft, een parkeervergunning aanvraagt of een hond neemt. U geeft deze informatie in goed vertrouwen en verwacht niet dat die tegen u kan worden gebruikt. Maar sinds kort gebeurt dat wel. De overheid kan uw informatie koppelen met allerlei andere bronnen en aan de hand van een risicomodel voorspellen of er met u misschien iets aan de hand is. Voor onze overheid bent u bij voorbaat verdacht. Zo is er sinds 2014 het systeem risicoindicatie, oftewel SyRI. Dat systeem wordt gebruikt om burgers te scannen op frauderisico's. Dat gebeurt zonder dat u het weet en zonder uw toestemming. Als u volgens SyRI genoeg lijkt op het gebruikte risicomodel, komt er automatisch een vlaggetje bij uw naam. U heeft misschien nog niets verkeerds gedaan, maar overheidsinstanties houden u dan wel scherper in de gaten. U weet dat niet. U krijgt dat niet vanzelf te horen. Maar hoe bepaalt SyRI eigenlijk of u een risico bent? Ook dat is geheim. Bent u al verdacht? Kijk op www.bijvoorbaatverdacht.nl.
I want to talk about SyRI's goals first. SyRI stands for System Risk Indication. It was adopted in 2014 by the Ministry of Social Affairs. SyRI produces risk notifications on citizens by making data analysis. It flags citizens who have a heightened risk of not complying with a very broad collections of laws in social security. And high-risk citizens end up in a registry for 2 years that the government authorities that use SyRI can access. SyRI's lawful, legal purpose definition is very, very broad. It says the prevention and combating of the unlawful use of public funds and provisions in the field of social security and income-related schemes, the prevention and combating of tax and premium fraud and non-compliance with labor laws. If I try to explain what SyRI aims at to my mother-in-law, I say the SyRI is out for every penny that you ever receive from the government or that the government expects to receive from you, whether it be taxes or unrightfully received social services, name it. SyRI's sources, therefore, are very, very broad. There are 17 categories of data. I'm not going to name them all. I've got only 20 minutes. But the most important one is tax data. That's a vast category that can contain hundreds of types of personal data. But all of these categories can contain dozens of types. And the highest government advisory council, the Raad van State, said the list is so broad that it is hard to imagine a type of personal data that is not covered in it. Where does SyRI get these data? From the five big public authorities that are actually make up the welfare state in Holland, in the Netherlands. They combine their databases, which are filled with data that people gave for a very specific purpose, a verification, so to apply for a social benefit, for a tax relief, for any social service that the Dutch government gives. And these data are centralized and combined for a very broad purpose, and it is risk indication. We want to know how this works. So we filed a freedom of information law request, which we asked, among other things, what the algorithms of SyRI were, what makes you, in according to SyRI, a high risk citizen. What combinations are made? How far can these combinations go? How many data are used in making these combinations? And according to what logic you are considered a risk by SyRI? Well, the answer was pretty disappointing. We didn't get to know anything about the workings of SyRI. It was all strictly confidential because the government fears that it will play into the cards of anticipating fraudsters, people who are calculating their behavior in order to stay out of the scope of SyRI. So if you would give anything away on that, people would know how to game the system. That's the legitimation of the secrecy of SyRI. What we did get to know about SyRI out of our Freedom of Information Law request is that it's been used in a neighborhood scale. So the government picks a couple of postal codes that are next to each other and analyze every citizen in that area for every law or misconduct that SyRI covers. So we call it a neighborhood troll net, a Wijksleep net, because it contains a lot of risk indicators that all citizens are scanned on in an area. And it has been exclusively used in very poor neighborhoods in the Netherlands. So that is one of our problems with SyRI too, which I will now go and talk about. We have compiled our objections to SyRI in a subpoena to the state. We sued the state in March 2018, more than a year ago. It is a very broad coalition of several Dutch NGOs containing privacy NGOs, but for instance also the biggest labor union in Holland, two famous Dutch writers, and a organization for legal professionals, which also contains judges and lawyers. So it's a very diverse and broad group, which also illustrates how broad the objections against SyRI are. We want to delete SyRI from law, of course. And our second goal is to spark a debate about the use of digital technologies in social security, but in society as a whole. Our core objection with SyRI is it is a carte blanche in a black box. The carte blanche part being the government is free to roam through these 17 categories that I just summed up. All your personal data that you ever gave to the government for some reason is fair game to use against you and that's the second part, in a secret manner. There's no transparency whatsoever about the workings of SyRI, as I just told you. And this creates, in our view, a paradox of transparency that shouldn't exist in a state of law. It's a recipe for distrust that our co-claimant, Maxime Februari, one of the two writers that also joined the case, pronounced as followed. If you're no longer assessed on the basis of violating a known norm, but based on secret risk profiles, the fear of repercussions is present in every contact with the government. And I think this sums up pretty well our problems with SyRI. It really creates a climate of distrust in every communication between citizens and the government. And it's a very bad starting point to use. Since we announced the court case, we saw the public debate on SyRI shift. And the first spark of that was when SyRI was used in two districts in the south of Rotterdam, the poorer part of Rotterdam, where 25,000 citizens were analyzed, which produced 1,200 risk notifications. So in almost half of the addresses that were scanned, there was a risk. So that was also a very high ratio of risk. One in 10 households is committing fraud or has a high risk of doing that. It didn't spark that much controversy when it was announced in the municipality bulletin, but when we really went to inform the people in the districts, they were actually very, very angry about it. They felt like they were treated like criminals, and it proved to us that if you inform people more about what is going on and not in a very superficial way, that they very well understand the problems with it and have issues with it themselves. This protest sparked a lot of media attention. And in one of the public meetings we organized in the community center in the district, one of the daily papers of Holland went and had this interview with a attendant. And I think it's very telling about the way people feel when they are being scanned in a way, like SyRI. Deeply offended is Majo Bukiu. The Rotterdammer has been living in the Netherlands for almost half a century. 50 years in which he worked hard as a carpenter at Blijdorpsu, as the father for his three children. They all have a job, he says proudly, and now this. With a swinging arm, he points to the apartment blocks in his Hillesluis neighborhood. They live there, the criminals. I'm one too. Apparently, I've worked for nothing all those years. That strikes me as very telling of the emotion that you get when you're suddenly confronted with a risk profiling system scanning you. After that, things went pretty quickly. The mayor of Rotterdam, who had first defended the use of SyRI, all of a sudden pulled the plug out of the SyRI investigation because he had a year-long conflict with the ministry who wanted to add the only two types of data that weren't yet in the scope of SyRI, namely police and medical data. And these are legally much heavier protected types of data than the data that I gave you before. After that, the Volkskrant revealed that SyRI hasn't got a single fraud since its existence. It's mainly because of technical problems and capacity problems with analyzing the data, but it also, in two projects, it appeared that the information that SyRI generated was already known by the public authorities using SyRI. So it really calls into question the added value of SyRI, which is, of course, a very important legal point. And last but not least, a week before the court case happened on October 29th, the UN Special Rapporteur on Extreme Poverty and Human Rights condemned SyRI in a letter to court, saying it was a digital equivalent of fraud inspectors knocking on every door, going through your files, looking at your water meter, your electricity meter, your anything that can lead to a suspicion. That's what I call SyRI when I try to explain it. It's like an automated search for suspicions at every house, every citizen. And that's why I call the publicity campaign by voorbaat verdacht. It's your suspected by default. And last but not least, last November, we won a Big Brother Award. It's an ironic award that's been handed out in the Netherlands every year. And a very high government official actually personally came to accept the prize, and he said, "Well, if you think we are going too far, you should tell us, and it's a good thing you took it to court so we can discuss it." And well, it was a very strange thing to say. I think it was always like he said, "Oh, you should have told us you have problems with SyRI." Then my future expectations for this project, the verdict is on February 5th. It's in a week. So I'm very excited on it. The stakes are high. The Dutch government has been investing in these practices for a very long time. SyRI has been used in pilots and experiments since 2006, before it came into law. So they have a very big stake in this. It's a case of the long run. If we lose, we will appeal because we want to set a legal precedent. So we have to go to the highest court if needed. And why the government would appeal is I just explained. I think that the debate climate in Holland is very right at this moment. Right now, one of the biggest scandals in maybe ever with the Dutch tech service is happening, which marked tens, maybe hundreds, and maybe thousands, it's not still clear yet, families of frauding with health, with childcare benefits. These families have to pay tens of thousands of euros back, which they don't have because they need social security to get by. And right now, it appears that the Dutch tax service has no had no proof whatsoever that these people were actually frauding. They just condemned them on a data analysis, and they just sweepingly said these are the fraudsters. And these people still don't know why they are being called fraudsters, because all of this information that led to them being a fraudster, according to the tax service, is confidential. So the debate is really shifting from normally a discussion about privacy in Holland. I don't know if that's the case in other countries too, ended with, well, if you have nothing to hide, you have nothing to fear. But right now, the main thing people are thinking is, what is the government hiding from us? What are they doing with our data behind the screens, and what impact could that have on me? And that's a good thing. 3 minutes left. Well, here you go. Any questions?
Didn't want to be so radical. Thank you.
I was on.
Any specific questions? For fundamental questions, there will be time afterwards in the general discussion, yes?
So, I work for insurance and risk. Why did you say that the government has a right to call someone a fraudster based on the data analysis? I mean, that sounds completely odd. And maybe the other case where you said is the statement from this one person who said he got like risk scan. So, what happens? People would get a letter that tells them you might be in risk?
Yes, they got a letter from the tax service saying, according to our information, you didn't have the right to childcare benefits, so pay it back. If you don't agree with it, you can appeal to it. These people all appeal to it. They literally had shopping bags full of documents handed to the tax service, and they still said nope. And right now, it's been for over a year. They have been trying to know why they have been marked as a fraudster, but they received their files, and they were all made black, so it's confidential. It's a big scandal. And I hope it opens up the debate a little bit more.
Any more specific questions?
If you lose at the Dutch courts, would you go on to a new European court?
Yes. That's our goal, actually. Because to give a little bit more background, the Dutch government, along with several other governments, really lobbied hard to making it an exemption in the GDPR to make legal space for laws like this that on a large scale give a new purpose to data that you already given for a specific purpose to the government. Well, they adopted it. Well, the thing that happened is that the parliament didn't give it any attention. It was a hammer piece. It's something that you accept without having any debate. The week before the court session was had taken place, a Dutch daily asked a few parliamentary members from, what were you doing back then? And they said, well, not really that. So they just didn't see what was on the table back then, and they accepted it without any debate.
Yes.
Another question with legal advisors. Is it based on nothing task?
Yes. Yes. Article 6.4, you probably know about it.
And you had a question?
Yeah, actually it's more related to the political response. Are people updating like their policies, or are they like politicians saying, oh, if we vote us on the next cycle we will remove this, or has like
Well, since the debate around SyRI was really going on, a lot of politicians said Yes, we are actually having another stance right now. So we changed our minds, but right now it's under the judge. So we're not going to change anything before the judge has a verdict. And I think that's a good thing because it's not their turn anymore. It was their turn when it was in parliament and they didn't do nothing. So they didn't do anything.
Okay, thanks a lot, Ronald. This was a very interesting